Father. God, you are with us. You are our God. And Father, you are the one that continues to bless and care and provide for us every day of our lives. And Father, we thank you for that. And God, we just pray, Heavenly Father, today, tonight, Heavenly Father, Lord, is just asking that you would cleanse us from all of our unrighteousness. God, forgiving each one of us of the sins that maybe we don't realize we've committed, or sins we've grown callous to, or sins we realize we've committed. Whatever they may be, Heavenly Father, we ask you to forgive us of those sins, please. God, have mercy upon us. Helping us, God, to be that which you would have us to be, Heavenly Father, to be a blessing to you, God, to honor you, Heavenly Father, to commune with you tonight, Heavenly Father. We ask you, Heavenly Father, that your way and your will be done, Father, in this service tonight. Lord, as we are few in number, Heavenly Father, Lord, but no doubt mighty in spirit, God, for your backbone of the church, Lord, is here. And Father, your word says, we're, you know, Heavenly Father, there's just two or three gathered together, that you will be in the midst. And Heavenly Father, we are counting upon you filling this place with your Holy Spirit, Heavenly Father. For God, even though we're few in number, we still want to feel your touch. We still want to, your presence, Heavenly Father, to be here, Heavenly Father, with us. God, we thank you, dear God, for that. Lord, we pray for Pastor Carter Meyer as they're away on vacation. God, we ask you to continue to touch and bless, Lord, giving them a time of relaxation. Just bless them, Father. We pray with a good time and bring them back safely from home to us, Lord. We pray free of harm, Heavenly Father. For Jim and Sue, God, continue to bless Brother Jim and healing and Sue as she cares for him. Lord, for Charlie, dear God, is seemingly has a very long road ahead of him, God. We ask you to please touch, Lord, that you will shorten that road, Heavenly Father, Lord, and get his healing started much quicker. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, that you would touch and help Mary. Dear Father, she no doubt struggles with her future. Heavenly Father, with what is tomorrow holds. Give her strength, Heavenly Father. Touch her, Lord, and help her care for Charlie, Lord, we pray. Father, we pray, dear Lord, for all those who are traveling. Dear Heavenly Father, you just bless them, dear Father, in a special way, all of Mary and Charlie's kids traveling home, those who are still yet trying to get here, bless them all with traveling mercies. Those in our church traveling, bless them, God, as they travel to and fro, Father, we ask. And Father, for Brian, dear Lord, as he has attained a new job, we just pray, Lord, that this will be the job that helps him, Heavenly Father, to make the changes he needs to make, Father, that he will retain this, that it will be good for him, Father, and that it'll just be a blessing to his life, Heavenly Father, as he gets this new truck driving job. That God, it'll just be a tremendous blessing to him, Father. We just pray, God. Father, for Kathy Miller, Lord, and the issues that she is dealing with in her life, Lord, that you know about, God. Touch her and help her, Father, in a special way. Dear Father, that you would deal with those life issues and help her to understand, God, that you are the one that is helping to deal with those in her life. Father, for all those family members that probably each one of us have that don't know you in the free pardon of sin, Father, we are asking, Heavenly Father, for the convicting power to fall upon them. God, that they may come to know you in the free pardon of sin before it is eternally too late. And Father, we ask for a lesson tonight, God. You would speak to each one of us through this lesson tonight. God, there will be some familiar things said tonight, Lord, that hopefully are reminders to this strong body of Christians, Heavenly Father, that are here tonight. And Lord, we just pray that as someone goes along with the message this morning, God will just help encourage us as we go along our last pathway. But Father, we give you praise, we give you honor, we give you glory. God, just help us tonight, Lord, for we need you. And as always, Heavenly Father, as we are this morning, we'll always be the rest of our life, Lord. We are unworthy to stand. Heavenly Father, we just ask you to work through our unworthiness and speak through these lips of clay. And Father, just allow to be said what you once said. For God, we give you praise, honor, and glory, precious and holy name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Bibles and turn to Psalms 34, verse 18. Chapter 34 of Psalms, verse 18. Don't really have a set scripture that we're going to base tonight off of. It says, "The Lord is nigh unto them that are of a broken heart, and save such as be of a contrite spirit." Number one, when we experience personal sorrows in our life, we often wish we could escape sorrow, the pain, the grief, the loss, a failure, or even a small daily frustrations that constantly wear us down. God promises to be close to the brokenhearted, to be our source of power, courage, and wisdom, helping us through our problems. Sometimes He chooses to deliver us from those problems, but other times God wants us to lean on Him and let God's love cause our sorrows to pass. Oftentimes the sorrows that we go through in life, they often seem a lot longer than what the sunshine we experience. You know, when you apply that to work, you know, it seems like the weekends just fly by so fast. And, you know, Friday, you're looking forward to the weekend, and like you snap your fingers and you're back at work thinking, did I even leave? You know? Life seems to be that way. We focus on the bad things and how seemingly long the bad things in life are and how short the good things in life are. But when sorrows strike in our life, God does not want us to get frustrated with those sorrows. But God, instead, we need to admit that we need God's help and thank Him for being by our side. God knows when we're suffering. God knows when that sorrow is in our hearts. And God says that He is nigh unto them that are of a broken heart. You know, as we think about Mary, and we pray for Mary, knowing that she is in a broken heart, having a broken heart, you know. Even seeing signs yesterday that she's still trusting in God. You know, she's still, Charlie's in God's hand. We'll be all right. You know, and that's the faith. You know, it's easy for us to trust in God when things are going okay. It's easy when we're on the mountaintop, you know, I've got faith in God, things are going great. But it's when we're on our backs that trusting in God sometimes becomes difficult. Letting go and letting God take care of the situations in our life is when it becomes difficult. But yet, that's when we need God the most. Because oftentimes we don't have the answers to dig our way out of the hole sometimes we find ourselves in. Whether we put ourselves there or whether circumstances have put us there. God says He is nigh unto them that are of a broken heart, and saveth such as to be of a contrite spirit. God is saying that I'm going to be with you through these sorrowful times. And He's in a sense saying this time is going to pass. You know, I'm not going to allow you to dwell in this time all of your life. But this time is going to pass. When sorrows strike, don't get frustrated with God, but instead, as I've already said, admit that we need God and trust in Him in these times. Ecclesiastes 7, verse 3, says, "Sorrow is better than laughter." Well, that seems to be a bit of a contrast, doesn't it, to what Solomon has said. It says, Ecclesiastes, "Sorrow is better than laughter, for the sadness of the countenance, the heart is made better." As we said, this contradicts what Solomon talked about. Eat, drink, and find satisfaction in one's work. To enjoy what God has given. But we are to enjoy what we have while we have it, while we can. But realize that adversity also will strike. Adversity reminds us that life is short. It teaches us to live wisely and refines our character. Christianity sees value in suffering and sorrow. Christianity sees sorrow as a refining fire. Most would agree and learn about God from difficult times. than from happy times. You know, oftentimes we give our testimony about what God has brought us through. You know, when you ask for testimonies in church, oftentimes it is what God has brought me through. A difficult experience that someone has had. The loss of a child, the loss of a job. Something along these lines that how God has brought them through a difficult situation. A refining fire, so to speak, that people realize what God has done in their life. This is the sorrowful times that what Ecclesiastes is talking about. What talks about sorrow is better than laughter because we see God in those difficult times. Oftentimes in our lives when we are on the top of the mountain, so to speak, we're not on our knees as much. But this sorrow being better than laughter, we find ourselves in a position of prayer, needing God. Lord, I can't get through this without you. I need you to help me in this situation. And that, in a sense, draws us closer and closer to God. Because God has orchestrated this world and our path in a sense that we need to have a reliance upon Him. God doesn't want us, in a sense, ever in our Christian walk to ever have a reliance upon our own strength. That's when we'll fall. And we will consistently fall when we feel like we have arrived. I've made it. Lord, I'm a mature Christian. I have a good foundation in the doctrine. I am strong. I'm getting from here. We're going to fall. We must never have self-reliance. We must always have that reliance upon God. And that's why when we look at Ecclesiastes 7, it says sorrow is better than laughter. We look at it in that sense that that sorrow drives us to God. It drives us to our needs, our dependence, our reliance upon God to solve our problems and our situations. You know, much like Cheryl's testimony this morning, not knowing where they're going to end up, there's a lot of unknowns in their future. And not worrying about that, knowing that God is going to lay out the path and solve the problem. The view of our struggles is a great opportunity to learn from God. And those are life lessons that we seldom forget. We seldom forget those life lessons of difficulties. And oftentimes we translate those to those who are going into difficult situations. So when we experience these personal sorrows, we know that this too shall pass. It won't stay with us. Number two, when we're experiencing fear, the Bible says, talks about fear 740 different times. Isaiah 41:10, which is probably one of my most favorite scriptures, it says, "Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with my right hand of righteousness." Now the scope of this verse is to silence fear. Oftentimes I had a little problem with it this morning. You know, when I was about 4:30 this morning, I woke up and you know, I had to think on these things because I was having some fear issues myself with the things that are coming up and, you know, financial issues with my daughter wants to have a wedding at the house and all the money it's going to take to pull that off and, you know, you have to get the cold sweats and all that kind of stuff. It's like, I'm going to pay for all this. And so Satan wants us in that state. We become restless. We aren't looking to God. We're looking to how we can figure these things out. And we get anxious. We get put back in a sense that, you know, how am I going to fix this? You know? And it's not I. It's God. Lord, you know my situation. And you know it's kind of out of my control. And I need your help and assistance. And he says, but fear not, for I am with thee. He wants to silence those fears and encourage our faith in God, in our distresses. We should not fear the threats of Satan, because when we get in that state, these are threats from Satan. These are anxieties that Satan shoots in our mind that we, as Christians, have got to put the shield of faith up and knock away. Satan, any time, we find ourselves experiencing fear, it is Satan. It is not of God. God says, I will not give you that spirit. I will not give you that spirit of fear, ever. It's a promise from God. So we can rest assured if we're experiencing fear, confusion, all of these spirits, it is not of God. It is a spiritual, satanic attack in our Christian life. From the devil himself, wanting to disrupt our lives. And memorizing Isaiah 41:10 is a good verse to memorize. Fear not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. I will help thee. I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. We should not doubt the promises of God. We should not fear the perishing in our afflictions, or fear that God's promises of his deliverances will fail. They will not fail. It is against the mind of God that his people should be fearful. God assures us in his purposes that he will suppress our fears. We do not need to fear because, number one, God is with us. He simply says that in Isaiah 41:10. We do not need to fear, number one, because God is with you. He says, I am with you. Number two, God has established a relationship with us. He says, I am your God. He doesn't say you can, in this verse, he doesn't say you can come be my children. He says, I am your God. It's an invitation. It's a father to a child relationship. I'm your daddy. God's saying, I am your God. A personal relationship, a term of endearment, a caring. In a sense, God's wrapped his arms around us. I like that. I am your God. Not somebody else's. He's your God. Joanna, he's your God. He's my God. I thank God for that. Thank you. God gives us assurance of his strength. He said, I will uphold you with my strength. Who is stronger than God? Who can defeat God? Nothing. And yet he says, I will uphold you. I will give you my help. Who can help us better than God himself? Nobody. And he says, I will help you. That is a promise from God. He gives us victory over sin. He gives us victory over death. And do we realize all the ways that God has helped us in our lives? You know, all the provisions God gives us. God speaks with tenderness. Fear thou not, for I am with thee. God is present with us at all times. Are we weak? God will strengthen us. Are we in trouble? God will help us in our time of need. Are we ready to fall? God will uphold us in his right hand, which is full of righteousness. Christ is the ultimate power over the evils of this world. And if we won't lean on him, when Satan causes us to fear, our fears will pass. I've been in these times where that fear feels like it's going to overtake you. And begin to pray. Begin to ask for God's help. And those fears subside. There's a calmness that comes in our life when we begin to pray, when we begin to trust God. Satan can't stand against those prayers. Satan can't stand when the presence of Christ is near. He has to flee. He can't be there. He can't stand the presence of Christ. Because the power of God and the presence of Christ is more than Satan can bear. And when we experience these things, we know Satan is attacking. And we put up the shield of faith, the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, and gird our feet with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Satan has no choice but to run. He has to leave. And when we find ourselves in these situations, brothers and sisters, it is important for us to remember these things. Because sometimes we have to talk ourselves out of this fear. Because Satan, when he pulls out that arrow and he starts that fire, he doesn't stop with one. He's got a rapid fire machine bow and arrow gun. It's just bam, 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 bam. And he's firing at us as fast as he can. That's right. You know, he just keeps knocking us down, knocking us down, knocking us down. If we stay there, he'll keep us there. But we have a responsibility for our own life, don't we? We need to begin praying, seeking God, singing a gospel song, you know, digging our way out, so to speak, if you will, but not in our own strength. We simply begin thinking about things of God and praying that God helps us through these situations. And these fears will pass. These fears will be calm. 2 Timothy 1:17, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, and of love, and of a sound mind. God hath not given us a spirit of fear, but of love, which enables us to hear, believe, hope, and endure all things. And this is a motivation to all obedience. The spirit of love will carry us through these oppositions. A sound mind implies much more. It means a clear understanding, a sound judgment, a rectified will, holy passions, and heavenly tempers. The whole soul harmonized in all of its powers and reasoning. The mind is completely synchronized and influenced to think, speak, and act in all right things. That is the sound mind that the Bible speaks of. It's not a mind of confusion. It's not a mind of fear. God does not give us that. God says, I give you this mind. Cleanness, of clearness. I give you a sound mind. The spirit of power is courage and resolution to meet difficulties and dangers. The Holy Spirit is not the author of a fearful or cowardly nature or of unquestioning fears. The Holy Spirit of power gives us the authority to square up face to face with Satan and command him to get thee behind me. Flee, leave me alone. God is the victor, and Satan, you are the loser. We have that power, we have that authority to tell Satan to get behind me. God has given us that power. Romans 8:31, what shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? If God be for us, who can be against us? God, who is infinitely wise, cares enough to direct us. God, who is infinitely powerful, cares enough to protect us. God, who is infinitely good, cares enough to save us. What cunning strength, malice, can prevail against God's wisdom, power, and righteousness? Nothing. Therefore, those who love God are saved. We shall not sustain damage by the persecutions of ungodly men, but even these persecutions work together for our good. While God is for us, we may be holy, boldness, defy all the powers of darkness. Who shall separate us from the love of God? There is nothing that can separate us from the love of God. Number three. This too shall pass when trials come. I put this in here. I have taught this before, but I felt pressed to put this in here again.
Oftentimes,
we as Christians, we misquote this, and I've heard it even since I've taught it before. And trials are going to come, right? Sometimes trials are more than we can bear. The Bible, does the Bible say God will not put more on you than you can bear? Does the Bible say that? The Bible does not say that. Although we as Christians tell others, well, God's not going to put more on you than you're able to bear. I've heard that in this church many times. And I've heard it other places. And it's just, the Bible does not teach that. And I don't want to teach something that's not right. And I don't want people thinking something, well, what? You know, I'm at the point of giving up. God, I want to die. I thought you said you wouldn't put any more on me than I could bear. Why are you doing this to me? Why are you letting this happen to me? And if we rightly divide and understand the Word of God, we'll understand sometimes why we're in these situations. The Bible, this is a very, very commonly held belief. But we as Christians got to stop saying this because it's not the Bible. It's just not in the Bible. You hear the pulpits, you hear Christians repeat it, trying to encourage one another. And they are words of encouragement, but it's scripturally not true. There is nothing in the Bible that says this, that God will not put more on you than you can bear. There's nothing in the scripture that says that. Since it is not found anywhere in Scripture, how did we come to misquote this belief? It is actually a twisting of the following verse from 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, if you want to turn there, so you can see this with me. And, you know, we have taught this before, but I felt pressed to do it again. 1 Corinthians 10, 13 says, there hath no temptation, not trial, there hath no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. Now we must first make a distinction between temptations and trials. They're not the same thing. You see, in this verse in question, is actually referring to temptations, not the weight of a circumstance, a religious duty, affliction, trials, or tribulations. God won't allow you to be tempted beyond your ability to resist a temptation. He sure will allow things to happen to you that you can't bear. Temptations are different than trials. Temptations are things that are put before you that will cause you to sin. Whatever the temptation is in your mind, think of how Satan tempts you to commit a sin. That is a temptation, not a trial. Okay? Trials are different than temptations. They are not the same thing. So that's how people have come to misquote the scripture, because they kind of put trials and temptations into the same bucket. And they're two different, totally two different things. Trial is something that we go through, that we bear. Something that may have not, you know, may have been cast into our lives, a loss of a family member, a loss of a child, you lost your home, your house burnt down. These are trials. Temptations are things that Satan puts in your way that cause you to sin. You know, for a man, it may be looking upon a woman wrong. It may be, oh, who's that $100 bill there? Oh, excuse me, buddy. You know, I need that money. You know, the difference. And so there's no word in the Bible that says, I'm not going to put a trial on you that you're not able to bear. It says, I won't put a temptation on you that you're not able to resist and give you a way out. So when people lose a child, a lot of Christians say, oh, God, you know, God's not going to put more on you than you can bear. We've just misquoted the scripture. You can't say that. That's why oftentimes when I go to funerals, I'm not saying what I'm saying right, but I simply oftentimes just say, you're in my thoughts and in my prayers. I'm so sorry for your loss. I don't pray for you. And I don't say, because at that moment in time, not a lot of words are going to comfort that soul of God. We just need to pray that God will comfort them and help them through that trial. In fact, many times people you see people in the Bible being in serious conditions beyond what they can bear. Jesus wept so that his blood became as sweat drops of blood. He was so distressed over the inevitable sacrifice and that he was tortured until he died. You don't think Jesus was in a position? He was in such agony that that sweat became blood. The corpuscles in his body no longer sweat. They were oozing the blood out of the sweat glands. He was in distress. God can and will at times allow trials to be in our lives more than what we can bear. 2 Corinthians 1, verses 8 and 9. This is Paul here talking. And it says, for we would not, brethren, have you ignorant of our trouble, which came to us in Asia, that we were pressed out of measure, above strength, inasmuch that we were despaired even of life. But we had the sentence of death in ourselves, that we should not trust in ourselves, but in God who raises the dead, who delivered us from a great death, who doeth deliver, in whom we trust that he will yet deliver us. We may think this isn't true, but it is God who will put more on us than we can handle sometimes. Why? Why would God allow that? Why would a loving God allow that situation to be more on us than what we may be able to possibly bear? Because he does not want us to rely on our own strength. This is oftentimes, you know, the Bible talks about pride and egos and, you know, what happens to men and women when our pride gets too big and our egos get too big? The Bible says, destruction cometh. When we get to a position in life where we think we have attained our strength and we've attained our success and we've reached the ultimate Christian maturity, Satan is going to drive us to the ground and we're going to crush us if we're relying on us. Now, I'm not saying that every Christian finds him or herself in a position that God has allowed one to be on them when they're able to bear. I'm not saying every Christian has to go through this. But some of us go through this because it's awakening. It's awakening upon our need and our dependence upon God. God wants us to rely on him. Our own works and our own courage in our own lives is not enough. Our own strength is not enough. He wants to do the work for us. He wants to be our strength. He wants to be our source of life. So sometimes God lovingly allows us to be broken by our circumstances. Paul said, it is above my strength. He didn't think he was going to make it. He said, what is his purpose? And why did God allow people or in this situation to be crushed? Paul felt like, I'm done. I'm over with. I'm not going to be able to go on. Paul felt that this trial was more than he could handle. Oftentimes God allows you so people will turn to God and trust him as their strength. And know that He is the only one who can successfully live that Christian life. Brothers and sisters, I got some bad news for us. We cannot live successful Christian lives on our own. We just can't. We are unsuccessful in that attempt. You know, and I say that because none of us died on the cross. We weren't able to die on the cross. We weren't sinless. God didn't choose us because He knew we weren't able to. He needed a sinless, flawless, pure sacrifice to die on the cross. And that's what Jesus did. Not you and I. And sometimes trials in life get to such a point that we can't bear them. And it drives us to our knees, to the point that we find ourselves depending and relying upon God and God alone to get us through these circumstances. So people have been misquoting this belief for many years that God will not put more on us than we can bear. But the truth is, God will put more on us than we can bear, because He does not want us to trust in our own strength, to live life, to trust in our own strength, to live this life, because we can't do it without God. He wants, and we should be our source of everything. He wants to bear these burdens for us. Does not the Bible say, cast all your cares upon Me, for I care for you? Sometimes if we start out casting those cares on Him immediately, we may not find ourselves in a situation where we're in a trial more than we can bear. Sometimes we need to just start casting those troubles on when they're small, instead of handing them ourselves and then they're too big for us to bear. We must live the life through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. As an example in the Bible, think about what Job went through. Job lost 10 children. He lost, can you imagine losing one child? How about 10? He lost 7,000 sheep. He lost 3,000 camels, 500 oxen, 500 donkeys, and a very great household with many, many servants. Job lost all his material possessions. He lost his friends. His friends accused him of sinning, and he didn't. And then his body was vexed with great painful sores and boils. His wife, on top of everything else, terribly discouraged Job and continually telling him to curse God and die. And yet God considered Job to be the most righteous man all over the east of Asia. Was Job in a situation that he could have bared that without God? We see Job throughout the scripture in the book of Job continually calling upon God. He didn't run away from God. He didn't lay down. He continued calling upon God in all these trials that he was unable to bear. Job called on God on his knees, asking for strength. But it wasn't Job's strength that God included. It was God's strength. Now we know the end of the story. God restored all that Job had lost, and even more. But Job was faithful to God through all these trials. Sometimes those things that we think are a curse in our life, and the Lord should take them away, are the very things that God uses to bring blessings in our lives. Sometimes those things in our lives that look like they are against us and will defeat us again are the very things that God uses in blessing and to bring blessing in our lives. It doesn't make a difference in conclusion what the trials are. Whether we have personal sorrow or we are experiencing great fears or trials are more than we can bear. God will, through His strength, help. He will help us. He will help us to find our way through if and only if we trust. Call on Him and use God's strength. He will cause our circumstances to pass and clear the way for us to begin blooming again. this morning, it's this morning talking about our failures and what we do with our failures. Tonight it's, you know, what we do with these fears in our lives and these trials in our life. It's what we do with these trials that make us a better Christian. Whether we run from God in our trials or whether we run to God in our trials, it's what defines who we become as Christians. And sometimes God allows difficulties to come into our lives so that we know where our strength is. Because it's not in us. You know, I've for many years competed in powerlifting. I always prided myself on being physically strong and reading God's Word, studying God's Word, thinking that I was a strong Christian, yet to find myself being defeated by Satan time and time again. So I finally got the message that, you know, Paul, you are no match for Satan. Quit fighting him and just get on your knees and pray and let God fight him. Because you can't win. And it took some hard knocks for me to realize that I can't beat Satan. As much as I'd like to square up and knock his head off his shoulder for the trials and temptations he's put in my life, I'd like to do that. But Jesus is going to do that for me. But he's who I have to rely on. On my knees, in prayer, in his book, rely on him for my situations. That's my strength. Isaiah 41, he's my strength. He's my upholder. He's the one who's going to get me through life. So, that's all I have tonight. Does anybody have any thoughts, people, anything like that? Adam?
When you go through a trial and you can't sin, God can also change your view of it. How you look at it, you just determine that it's going to be this way, you know. But if you
now, no, I don't know if you understand. No matter how